is called A House for Essex and Other Stories, and it's a bit of a new kind of lecture to give, because as the introduction suggested, I'm in a new phase. Having been a director of an architecture practice called that for nearly 20 years, I've now recently started a new practice. And so I've been used to talking about my work and my practice's work and a sort of kind of legacy of work in a certain way. And I'm now just starting to really talk about that stuff differently and to introduce new work as well. So this lecture is a bit of a work in progress in a way too. And it spans both practices in a way, just to give you an idea of how long ago we started that. This is the three of us, Sam Jacob on the left, me in the middle and Sean Griffiths on the right, and this is us as relatively fresh-faced graduates, probably in the late 1990s, in sort of early formation of FAP. And we practiced together we started in the kind of mid-1990s, we finished the practice in 2013, which is a fairly unusual career move, I have to say, having spent 20 years establishing practice, decided to stop it just as you're getting successful. It's, I can recommend it as a sort of psychological exercise, it's very therapeutic, but it's a bit nerve-wracking at the same time. So some of you might have seen this, which we did as a sort of finally getting it all out of our system over the summer, which was that we edited, guest edited an edition of the Architect's Journal called The Death and Life of the Architect. And we had some different views between us. It was going to be called just The Death of the Architect. And we tried to make it, we tried to leave some room for optimism, and also to talk about the practice. Represented in quite a lot of architectural conversations, and certainly mainstream ones, which is that the things that happen in architecture as compelling or interesting as the architecture itself. And one can see a sort of history of architecture, certainly history of architectural representation, which tries very hard to deny the act of occupation. There's a, you know, the classic cliched architectural photograph, which this is also one, I know, doesn't include any people and doesn't really include mess and clutter of every day. And that's something that's sort of always interested us. You could see as a sort of schism between, on one hand, a love of architecture in its sort of most pure form, sculptural qualities of architecture, the compositional qualities of architecture, and on the other hand, all the things that go to kind of mess that up, which is us, people who generally tend to not live in architecture in the way that architects prescribe it to be done. And that particularly interesting in relation to housing, I guess, which is an area where people have the most influence over the architecture that they occupy. And you'll see that hopefully in the houses that I'm going to show shortly. So this was a little project that explored that idea of how a bathroom has a whole lot of sort of subtext about our lives and attitudes to privacy, attitudes to kind of home, all sorts of things. So we made this kind of bathroom, which is about this sort of couple who wanted to share everything, and of course the subtext, I guess, is really communicates that you can't share everything. There's a deep frustration in that. So the other thing that happens is you take these objects, these sort of bits of ceramicware and stuff, and when you start cutting up playing them, you realise they're incredibly rich and suggestive form. So when we started to put them together, we got all these kind of weird sort of clefts, bulbous bits, and sort of strange protuberances that spoke about the kind of thing we were interested in, the kind of, I guess, the realm of the body within architecture, the realm of this sort of doubling and a slightly sort of surreal, sort of freakish Frankenstein monster. Probably most apparent in this full frontal view of two toilet bowls which are angled away from each other for modesty. That's an interesting project to start with, I guess, because it sort of shows a technique or a set of sort of approaches, which is the manipulation of existing things. We've always been way more interested in that, or I've always been more interested in that than perhaps the creation of absolutely new things. And an interest in the relationship between how we occupy space and the more abstract ideals we might project onto those spaces as well. In a way, that thread, those two threads, kind of run through hopefully all of these projects. This is another little project. I've put a sort of few smallish sort of fat projects, which are, in a way, small objects that have an incredible amount of ideas. Possibly too many thrown at them in the way that young-ish architects tend to operate when given the opportunity. We were commissioned by an art organisation in Holland, in Den Haag, to design a security hub for a bike park. So when you cycle around The Hague, so places where you can leave your bike, then you pay a small amount of money and basically the security guard looks after you, so there's a car park. And there are a number of these, and the security guards, these are sort of developed in an ad hoc way, so the security guards tend to sit in either porter cabins or recycled shipping containers, and various things like that. And this art organisation had the idea to commission 10 new ones that would be developed precisely for that, designed for that purpose, and they asked us to design one. And ours, we called ours Nonument, because in a way it was a very small piece of infrastructure that was wanting to be something much grander, much more ambitious. And we looked at certain things that were both local, which were kind of houses which were nearby. The bit of the Hague that we were given was a really interesting place for Schreven, which is actually essentially a Dutch seaside resort. And it's on the North Sea coast. It's pretty much opposite Lowestoft, particularly the UK coast, except it's even bleaker than Lowestoft. Hard to get that much bleaker than that. So it has this kind of huge swathe of windswept beach, and then a whole load of nightclubs and bars and clubs and all those things. Here it starts. Here, look, fundamental piece of kind of neoclassical rational architecture. I'm kind of fascinated by the do, but that's probably another subject altogether. But this is an early drawing we did of our monument, which was a hill with a little building on top, and then the building on top would catch fire periodically. And so initially it was a kind of really terrible English joke about the Dutch landscape that we had made the open hill in Holland. And then on top of it would be a house called Fire that would have some element of being slightly kind of surreal and a little bit kind of uncanny and maybe a little bit disturbing, but at the same time it's a bit like a lighthouse or a bit like those the things on groins on the kind of coast which light up the worn ships that are coming towards the beach and stuff like that. So the series of associations of this thing. And it mutated slightly into something which became a bit more Ledoux-like, so it actually became like a sort of truncated pyramid that was sort of pushed into a castellated fortress. And then it had a strip window and a little house on top. And a person sat in there during the day listening to the radio and making sure that your bike didn't get nicked. And because it was fitted with neon smoke machine, some sort of endorsement for the idea that this theatrical little object would have a kind of life beyond its very humble programme, which was secure. Okay, so I'm just going to talk about housing, and then talk about one of the larger projects I did as part of that, which was in, or still is in, Ancoats in Manchester. I don't know if anyone's seen the programme Shameless, has been on for that for a while, but it's set near to the kind of Ancoats area, and is in fact actually certain segments of that programme were filmed in the pub that was opposite the houses. The pub scenes were all filmed in the pub that was opposite the houses we designed. And we were, it's an interesting project for a number of reasons. One, it was the first sort of largest commission that we were given, and for a long time, possibly still, we were seen as slightly outsiders, I guess, when we won this job. They said Mavericks with housing. This is kind of a weird tag, I suppose, that sort of follows around. So it's quite a big commission for us. And it's also an interesting commission because the reason we won that commission were twofold. One is, I like to think it's because of our attitude towards housing and some of the things that we talked about, which is perhaps a kind of very, in a sense, a sort of unarchitect view of housing, which is kind of being as interested as you are in sort of architectural perfection when you hand it over. But the other probably real reason that we won the commission is that we forgot to bring a laptop with us when we went to the interview, and we thus couldn't show them any of our previous work. So we went to an interview with the residents and with Urban Splasher and the developers and the Housing Association, and we didn't show them any of our work. We just talked about what we were doing. And to our amazing surprise, they gave us the job. And when they rang us up and said we'd given the job, they said it was so refreshing that unlike all the other architects, you didn't come in and just show us loads of glossy images of your work. And we were like, I quite didn't note that one down. But never show images of your work when you go to win work. But it was a super interesting project because it involved working with the residents of an existing council estate in Ancoats in Manchester to develop 23 new houses that they would live in. And so it involved fairly intensive period of consultation with them, and in a way, a sort of a very creative to and fro about our ideas and their ideas. And so, what came out of it, I think one of the things that we put across at the interview fact that they didn't actually have a great deal of sympathy for kind of contemporary architecture was a sort of interesting challenge rather than a sort of limitation to the project. So in a sense, their brief, which is that they didn't want to live in the apartment blocks that were being planned elsewhere in this large estate, but they wanted to live in something that they called traditional architecture, seems to us a really interesting thing. Like, what did they mean by that? I'm kind of thinking, you know, certainly weren't interested in doing something that could be described as traditional, but we also want to do something that did speak of their values. We did a series of workshops with them. We went to their existing houses, we took photographs of their existing houses, and we started to use that to form a brief. And this is one of the first houses we went to, which we always thought was very weird, because welcome dog with an air freshener. The really weird thing about this is it's outside, in the hall. So it's kind of a welcome dog, but also sort of a statement about the owner's attitude more or less to the rest of the world. Which was one decided kind of mixed feelings, I suppose. But lots of sort of utopian ideas that architects have, especially about housing, kind of bubbled, was like burst by this process, where, you know, we were suggesting that had a sort of communal utopian vision, and they were just basically just going, there's no way I want to someday next to that one. And you go, oh, well, okay, so our idea of this kind of beautiful communal garden is going to be quite a harder sell than we imagined. So we went into their houses and took loads of photographs and stuff, and we discovered lots of weird and wonderful things, which this is one. We discovered a thing about demographics and housing design, which is the older the resident, the more insane their interior is going to be. So this is obviously one of the older residents. They've designed this all themselves in a kind of adobe Tudor Beethoven manner, with an extraordinary collection of objects. Too many to sort of single out, but it struck us that this was like a really, really interesting folk architecture. It's not what architects want to talk about at all, but it is actually what a lot of people who live in an area actually genuinely like and wanted to kind of surround themselves with. And this became a really interesting challenge, but also an interesting theoretical kind of project. This is a bar owned by the guy who owns the dog, who appears later. Every time we went to have consultations with him, he'd offer us a drink from that mysterious red bottle that hangs on the side of the and we would resist that. Of course, it was brought back from sort of holiday about 25 years before. But this bar was interesting because he knocked a hole knocked a wall down between one bedroom house and the living room and wanted to make it a bar. And it's really interesting what people do with houses. It actually changed the kind of functional flair of his house. It changed the sort of stylistic quality of the business. He got a fish tank, he kept a carp, and he had an enormous carp pond in the garden. So all these things about how people change their houses are really interesting. This is another one. This is a really formal dining table, which is positioned in such a way that you couldn't actually get into the kitchen. Because it's a desire to have quite a sort of formal dining space, but a house that hasn't really been designed to have one. So we started to sort of formulate a brief out of these ideas. Here's another thing, which is a sort of desire for privacy, which again, we don't really factor in that much when we talk about housing design, the idea that teenagers might actually want to live anywhere but in the family home, or at least demarcate an area which is completely separate. So again, we were interested in that. And we started to do these drawings with them, which were about those kind of spaces. So we started to say, well, you know, very obvious things really, like a kitchen and dining room where you can be in one space together, but you can also go to the garden and you can see what the kids are doing while you're cooking and stuff. On the right, a space where everybody now has a computer, but maybe there's only one for the whole family, and certainly at that point in time as well, it's a sort of pre-iPad. So an idea that, well, where do you put a computer? Do you put it in the bedroom? And that makes you have to go into their bedroom to use it. So we started to develop an idea that maybe there's a space which is general, which is a kind of homework or home study space, which is sort of off the main circulation. And then the other drawing is the idea of maybe separating teenagers and parents and giving a certain sort of autonomy to the children in their own space. And another thing that started to be about decoration, which were about sort of personalization and the sort of objects that in particular tend to sort of appear or cling to openings, doorways, windows, sort of interfaces really between you press, certainly within modernist architecture, is seen as hugely decadent, problematic, or wasteful. There's a whole kind of ideological rhetoric about it. And yet it seems to us to be a hugely important component of how architecture and the interact with the people, how they more importantly interact with it. So we started to sort of think about how we could do it. The houses are in the circle of red at the top, they're on a football pitch, and effectively we've designed two parallel terraces with garden spaces between. And the terraces are made up of a series of L-shaped units, which are single story, and two story, and a couple of three stories, and are two, three, and four bed in size. So there are different size units, but the sort of common denominator is that they're L-shaped and they're formed around a courtyard. We have to provide a parking space, and yet a lot of the residents are actually quite old, and not necessarily all of them had a car. So we made a space. These are plans. This is a plan of a three-bed unit. You can see on the ground floor the space where you could park the car, but that could also become a kind of front garden. The L-shaped unit also means that you could divide it up in different ways, so that the living room, which is at the front, could be cut off, could have a doorway to the hallway, or could be more or less open plan. Again, you could swap the dining room and the living room around, so it's a sort of idea of flexibility. And when you go upstairs, the little bit of window seat is that kind of homework computer space, which is sort of a bit of circulation that's kind of grown in size to allow a table, seats, and also a nice view window. And then three bedrooms, and there's a balcony that looks into the courtyard. And there's also a whole number of sort of variations of the built into it. So the balcony could be in different positions, the balcony could be different designs. Layout could be tweaked. Some people started to have more separated walls because they didn't like the idea of open plan houses. So we built in, I guess, both decorative variation and programmatic variation into the plans. And we also, these are quite modest sized houses, so we also spent quite a lot of time in working out how the spaces could be as flexible in themselves as possible, i.e., you could move the furniture into as many different possible, which sounds incredibly sort of normal and boring, and yet actually you'd be surprised by how many new houses designed and built, but that isn't possible. And we worked on things like getting the kind of proportions of the room, floor to ceiling heights as generous as we could possibly make them, and certainly felt spacious. And then all of the houses were sort of united behind this kind of facade, which had a kind of highly decorated and elaborate sort of brickwork pattern, which enveloped the entire estate. So that the facade kind of goes around the whole of the outside, and the facade is taller, and a bigger scale, and more elaborate than the houses behind. So the facade, in a way, sort of sits not entirely independent of the houses behind, because there are correlations and tensions between the layouts of the houses and the design of the facade. But by moving the doors into the courtyard, we were able to sort of play with the facade as almost as a sort of pattern. So it looks, in one sense, quite homely, and it has definite elements of recognisable domestic architecture to it. But at the same time, it has a sort of abstraction about it as well. There's a sort of tension to us between the sort of and something else. And it was interesting because this anchor for this particular area is actually quite central in Manchester. And when we did the initial conversations with the residents, we asked them where they would ideally like to live, almost to a single person, references were suburban. So they lived in a very urban condition, but their sort of desire somehow was to live in a suburban condition. And the way these houses were a bit of a sort of hybrid between, you could see it was a series of semi-detached houses that were all held behind one facade, or as a long kind of urban facade that this path relates to the kind of master plan as a whole, so the changes in colour and brickwork, the changes in and out of sort of focus of the brickwork relate to sort of practical views of the houses in relation to the master plan, which is not where we're also. And so here's the word, three stories for the kind of facade sort of jumped up another size, and then you can see how kind of thick it is and how the profile of it is always sort of changing and referring in a way, sampling a whole series of sort of domestic architectural reference points. And in that view, which shows the kind of typical sort of Manchester real buildings, this is the first industrial suburb. This is quite an old project, and I think we did an exhibition in Manchester that predated this, and we called the exhibition Kill the Modern as We Live, which is a sort of a challenge to ourselves to try to think beyond what we thought would become quite a constraining ideology. But when we presented this a few years later, someone said, oh, you didn't kill the modernists within, you just got them to do the planning. So that the houses and the sort of house types themselves were quite rigorously planned, and the sort of flamboyance in a way is this kind of external treatment. And the interiors, the same, we worked this work very hard on trying to make quite simple, but developing the proportions to the rooms and the kind of spaciousness that allowed people to adapt to their houses a little bit, sort of decoration from the outside coming. So the staircase looked up to that window seat. And then this is one delighted owner. This is the man with the dish. When he moved in, he said, we asked him why he bought all this furniture, where his bar had gone. And he said, well, you designed a modern home, let's get some modern furniture. And we were like, damn. We kind of tried to do the opposite in a way. We tried to do something that reflected a lot of the sort of taste culture of the people in there. And I think this issue of taste culture is very interesting. Thorny one, it's always kind of like on a sort of knife edge of whether people think that it's appropriate in some way to try to understand the taste cultures of this sort of outside one's own culture as architects. So we turn to that. And there's a dog, which he hid next to the pot, which we built in the garden for the car, and then he put the dog minus his eyes, it seems. Guarding the carpet. Okay, this is sort of the end of one bit, beginning of another section. This is a stool that we designed called Soft Hercules, which is a sort of faux Greek god's head, which when you sat on it, distorted because it was made of foam. It turned out to be a strange and unplanned moment of success. What we haven't worked out is how to stop the phone going straight and shape together. Okay, so I'm going to show a couple of projects which are projects done as part of ordinary architecture, and I'm going to talk about House for Essex. This is a little project we did as a competition for the Soane Museum, which was for a piece of funeral architecture, it's called Tomb of the Unknown Craftsman. And it's a tomb for the forgotten, overlooked, and underappreciated projects that kind of in a way exist within architectural culture all the time. And it came from a bit I read in a book by John Summerson, who of course was the director and curator of the Soane Museum. I don't know how many of you have been to it, but it's amazing, incredible space designed over a number of years, sort of almost excavated by Sir John Soane. And I'll talk about it a little bit more in relation to House for Essex, because it's very influential on the design process of that house. But I read this thing in a book, in an essay by John Summerson, which is that Soane was an article to George Dance, who's an architect, and he was Dance was kind of his mentor, and so bought or acquired all of Dance's drawings and kept them in a sort of tomb in the basement of his house, which is a really odd thing to do, but also sort of a really compelling idea that you're, I guess, this debt he had to the person who taught him how to be an architect, and sort of have a shrine in his house. And so we made this object, which is an old-fashioned plan chest, formed into a ziggurat, made of stone, the sides of which, each side had one drawer open, and then there were kind of carved drawings inside. And on each corner of the ziggurat, an everyday object associated with kind of drafting from an office, this grey mount. There's some glue, there's some magic tape, and then surmounting the top is a set square. So in a way, it's a sort of celebration of the kind of lost art. And we made a model of this as displayed to the Soap Museum, which is all kind of very nice and sort of sat in the space that it inspired it was. There are two sorts of and into the side is kind of carved. Two more projects to show, and I want to talk about A House For Essex. And so I'm going to move through this one quite quickly, which is a house at the moment, which is actually a house in London, in Hampstead. It's on a steep hill, down a narrow pedestrian alley. So it's a very interesting site, very hard to get to site, quite a kind of obscure one. At the moment, there's a kind of brick wall, and there's a door in it, and you go to the door, and you can see the site. And the brief we were given to this is a house for people to stay in and kind of on the day left, rather than a house for Essex, was that it would be about, in particular, people who lived in Hampstead and the kind of art, literature, heritage of that place. And it became, in a way, that our design was a bit like if you had a sort of fantasy flat share of John Constable and John Keats and Sigmund Freud. And the interior of this house, these are sort of drawings. Freud, who lived in Hampstead just before he died. On the left, the collection of the sort of totem figures he had in his study. Constable, who lived in Hampstead, and painted constantly. And then Keats, who lived in Keats Grove, of course. And then, but not for that long, he dies very young, he goes to Grove, and he dies in the house. So the house that we designed becomes a sort of space where each of those people is embodied by a structure. And there are three structures. Each one has a sort of distinctive personality in a way. And each one is, well, two of them are 2 stories high, and one is 3 stories high, and each one contains a bedroom and a bathroom and a sort of living or relaxing space. This Constable one, which is in the top corner, also has a 3rd story, which is a rooftop studio, which has views towards the heat. So the inside is like a kind of landscape. And a bit of a sort of abstraction of the landscape in which the house sits, which is a series of narrow alleyways, changes of height and topography, in and around the building, just together. And the interior of the house is, in a way, a sort of reflection of the exterior. And the facade, it's on a steep hill, so the facade's sort of buried into the hillside, such that with a sort of grid of windows, such it looks as though the house is sort of half buried itself. So as you come down the alleyway, the height of the windows is kind of at your ankle height, and then they start to become real. Most of the windows are blind windows because they've got sort of a very narrow passageway shape of the house. So all of the windows, and to avoid overlooking issues, tend to be within kind of courtyard spaces, come down. And there's an idea that, in a way, the house is a bit like a ruin. Narrative is that there's an old house out of which a new one is coming. And it changes material and characters and goes around. And so this view shows that facade which becomes a kind of ruinous wall to the courtyard and another house behind, and then these objects popping out the roof, and the blue and the pink, the blue and the purple are two of the structures. man. So Freud's bit looks like Freud's bit. Then Keats's is a bit like a sort of house in terms of tree bowing in it, and Constable's is a sort of windmill type thing which stretches through the house as well as the roof. These are the objects. So the blue one is the studio, the pink one is Freud, and then the yellow one is Keats. So these objects are sort of exploring an idea, I guess, of narrative, storytelling in architecture, and how you might talk about, again, about personality and how it reflects in a domestic home. Okay, so round up. Talk about House for Essex, which is obviously a collaboration with this person, which is Grace and Perry. Pictured here on board is self-designed, customised motorbike patients on a cycle tour of Bavaria when he was given the town of Bavaria, which is twin with Chelmsford, which is the town that Grace had come from, which is also coincidentally where I went to school. He went to school with my brother. This came out after we were matchmade by Living Architecture, which is out at the Bolton's company, which has built a number of holiday homes around the UK, one now being built by Peter Suntour in Devon, another by John Porson in Wales, which is nearly finished, and by Andrew on TV, it's already done. And Alain de Bolton came to FAP with an idea that Grayson wanted to design something that was a kind of secular champion, and it would be about Essex, which was the county he came from. And this, by the way, I didn't finish that story, this is him. He was given the free man of Chelmsford. And when he was made a free man of Chelmsford, he decided that he would ride to Bavaria, to the twin town of Chelmsford in Bavaria, and present himself there in this custom design outfit with his bear, teddy bear, Alan Dean, which is on the shrine. So the house is, in some ways, the brief for the house is two different things. One is a house that you can stay in. One is it's a kind of wayside chapel, a kind of building, religious building typically that you find on a particular route, the pilgrimage routes, and that it would be a place where travellers would stop, and that, like most wayside chapels, it would celebrate saints. In this case, it celebrates a secular saint called Julie Cope, who is the woman in the pan there. And she is a sort of Essex everywoman. She's entirely the invention of Grayson, and her story is something that evolves through the design of the house. So her story doesn't really exist at the beginning of the house is designed, but becomes more and more concrete and developed as we did it. In a way that bits of her story come because of the house starts to look a certain way. Bits of it, and the house looks a certain way because of her story. So there's a sort of interesting relationship, especially to me, really, about the role that architecture has in making a narrative. It's not simply that the architecture illustrates the story, it's it sort of builds that story at the same time. This is just an example of two pilgrimage chapels. The one on the left, the pieces of the wall, is in essence itself, is one of the buildings that Grace and I went to visit when we started to develop. We were both very struck by this incredible monumental presence on much of the Essex coastline, its estuary, salt marshes and things. This is near Bradwell on Sea, and it's a very typical bit of Essex coastline. It's a kind of monumental building that sits on a very flat outlook over the coast. So it became quite an important touchstone for us. As I say, the project became about, in a way, it's about pilgrimage route, and the house and the site of the house is sort of the end of that pilgrimage. So the house is in the northeast tip of Essex, which is near Harwich. It's in a place called Grabness. And it's at the end, or it's on the Essex Way, which is kind of 80-mile walk, which can go from the edge of London all the way across Essex. It's pretty much where the house is. The house is sort of the site of the house, and you just chance it. It's kind of perfect as this sort of idea of a journey. And of course, the county of Essex, the ch- changes that occur in that county are very large, in the sense that you go from a kind of London sort of industrial fringe to a sort of agricultural north. And in a way, that journey is also a journey through social classes, as Essex becomes notably posher as you go north, and it becomes somewhat wealthier. So there's a sort of interesting thing about social geography of Essex. Some people might disagree with it. But you could say that, you know, Essex, sort of London overspill, is a very different place from the kind of agricultural edge that we suffer. And so there have become a bit about that as well. So this is a view of it for the site. So that down the bottom, this is a railway line. So the other thing about the site is you can get there on the train on Liverpool Street, you can get off to the Grand National, behind the little village station. You walk down a lane which is called Blackboy Lane, and the last site on that lane, the last house, and it looks over the Stour estuary, the Stour, which is super interesting because inland that becomes the river that reaches in Constable County, so the Hayway. It goes through Dedham Vale, basically, which is the landscape that Constable grew up in. All of his most famous early paintings are there. But one side sort of goes through what you could say is quintessential picturesque English landscape. On the other side, it kind of comes out into the North Sea between Harwich, Felixstowe, which are kind of big industrial ports, and in a way that sort of juxtaposition is also part of the story in miniature. And the house looked between two kind of copses of trees at this incredibly beautiful landscape of the Stour estuary. And the position of the house is very much so, it's a continuation of the past. So when you come down this route, Blackboy Lane, you kind of see this house at the end. And then when you finally walk into the house, kind of steps to one side of the way, you see this rather panoramic view. So the size of the house is very important. It's a footpath that goes along and round the outside of the So this is that view looking towards the Harwich container terminal. They're kind of incredible things. They're watching the ships being loaded and unloaded, and you don't see a single passenger. Kind of amazing amount of infrastructure, yeah, it's almost completely unpopulated. And so the things that we started to look at when we began the design process for this, one of the things that was quite interesting and related a bit to the Manchester House is that Grayson was deeply skeptical about contemporary architecture. He didn't like it very much. So that's an interesting challenge to start with. I had you work with something good, but my feeling about this house is it's not like most of the other living architecture projects, where there's a kind of what you could say sort of elegant simplicity and a kind of logical sort of layout of rooms and a desire to maximise the light and the views and stuff. This became something that's in a way very counterintuitive to that. It became something that's very insular. Despite the amazing view, the house often looked inward and the views only come occasionally. And it would be quite inscrutable from the outside. It might be difficult to gauge how big it was to play scale games. And it would be difficult to work out, indeed, what sort of house, whether it was a house or a kind of incredibly elaborate barn or some kind of chapel. So this is a stained church in Norway, which we was a sort of early reference point, and also important, I guess, that we wanted something which related to ideas of sort of folk architecture as well. This would be something that would have some of those qualities, particularly because Grayson's work is concerned with a kind of handmade focusness in terms of the objects he made. How we might, incredibly difficult to do is how you might make architecture doesn't lend itself to that at all, especially not contemporary architecture, as in like the world we work in as architects, where talking about handmadeness is deeply terrifying. And talking about something having a kind of folk quality is very difficult. We work in a very automated and extremely sort of systemized way these days as architects and construction people. So those are really super interesting questions. This is a much more local reference. This is Blackwall Church in Essex, which again had this sort of idea of, as you see in the house, as an object which kind of changes scale. We get different scale versions of the same thing. There's an elevation of the house, which is basically composed of four house shapes that get bigger as it steps down the hill. So it starts with a small object that grows, the house gets sort of bigger and more formal as it grows, and it has two ends. It has a sort of domestic entrance at the small end, and it has a more formal chapel entrance at the other. So in a way, the house has two very different faces. It appears very different to you whether you approach it from one direction or the other. So this is the sort of domestic entrance in a way, but it becomes quite a small object. Come the other way, it's an imposing object. And so again, we wanted something that would reflect the idea that what you effectively have here is a house that contains a chapel. And it's the relationship between those two, and the sort of drama of their relationship that becomes the real sort of driver of how it's planned and designed. It's clad in ceramic tiles, which obviously wasn't actually an immediate thought, but became a really obvious thing. Made of ceramic because Grace is a potter, but it wasn't our first idea. And we were very intimidated by is how you could sort of make a whole building of stuff that had any of the sort of qualities of these first things. And we were lucky in finding an amazing manufacturer in Preston who made these incredibly beautiful, incredibly detailed, precise tiles. And precise in the sense that they even kept the wobble. So the sort of preciseness was not necessarily that you'd end up with something that was perfect, but that it would somehow translate the qualities of the initial things into an object that you could build a building with. And so these are kind of early trials, and the woman in the arch is Julie herself, and she's sort of pregnant. And she then becomes a sort of main building block on the outside. And then there's a number of triangular tiles which contain symbols associated with her life. Challenge then in a way became to start composing the facade that made sense with these objects. These are unglazed versions of some of the symbols, so there were kind of cassette tapes and J's and Essex shields, nappy pins, all sorts of symbols that relate to her life. They look like slices of cheesecake, they have incredible edible quality of these objects. This is the glaze for the green and white ones. Really nice thing about jumping them in the middle and having a kind of exposed section of the cassette tape or something that you can kind of read on the outside of the building. And this is then laid out in the yard where they were made in Preston, where we were starting to check every single dimension of every single tile. We were the architects that worked with that had the widest tolerance range for discrepancies of dimensions. We wanted to have, and again with the colour and stuff, and the glazing, it moves quite a lot in colour, and that's not something that one normally has in a kind of architecture process. You're trying to eliminate that variation, keep it. So this is a sort of bit of the facade in place. You can see the kind of relationship, the composition of the main Julie tiles, and then these symbols and triangles. And there it is, playing in the landscape. You can see very clearly the way that the same object is sort of scaled up as it goes down the hill. So the dormer windows in the smallest bit become kind of huge clear storage windows for the largest bit. And so the large section at the end is the chapel with its own kind of porch and entrance. And then there's a series of sculptures on the top, which is Julie herself, the wheel which symbolises her death, which I'll show you a little picture of. A sort of lantern which lights up at night, and then a large egg which is the chimney pot. It's probably the most terrifying bit of the whole design process. It still slightly gives me the heebie-jeebies when I think about the size and weight of that chimney pot being great to place. And so here's a really nice view of it where you can see the lights of the port in the background on the right, and all the dormer windows lit up, and that scale game of like a sort of Russian doll telescoping zoom space is most heavenly. And you can see it's an incredibly beautiful place, which we were talking about before the lecture, which is a kind of very undiscovered bit of the world in a way, kind of North Essex coast. And so I'm just going to do a little walk through the house to finish with, which is so this is the sort of domestic entrance, the doors open up, and you go through a series of spaces which very formally organised, and they owe a debt to lots of architects that I particularly like, Most notably, the way kind of Edmund Upton's these houses are set up, these very formal, rigid hierarchies, and then sort of narrowly subvert those. So, what seems to be the ground group is something terminates in the blank wall, and you realize you have to kind of go and find the room somewhere else. And so, the kind of wit and drama of those plans becomes very important to us, as well as the Soviet stuff about. In a way, this house is a mausoleum, effectively. It's a very Soviet thing. It's a house where the person will be an imaginary one. So, this is her final resting place. So, here's the house. View from the other end, the entrance of the chapel. And again, a nice view where you can see a port in the background. And the tiles, you know, have this incredible sort of sculptural, three-dimensional quality. If it wasn't the bright red, it would actually be quite tasteful. Okay, so how the house works is. Very quickly, there's an anecdote that we had about it, which is the thing about Graham Greene, the novelist, and he was brought up in the school, and his father was the headmaster, and they lived in the school. And the separating bit between the house, the bit they lived in, and the bit where the school was a green baize door. And if you pushed the green baize wall, you were in an assembly hall. And so there's a kind of idea that you didn't know it was there, or it was a kind of secret. And this becomes the point between the house, which is these three bays, and the chapel, which is this bit. Almost that you could live in this bit and not know that this bit exists, and that people could come in this bit and not know there's a house beyond. And so there's a number of devices, mirrors and hidden doors and things that increase the sort of drama of that difference. This is it at night. Oh yeah, the other thing, so very briefly, how long have I got? Nearly done. Okay, her life, she's born in Canby Island in the flood in 1953, and then she moves to Basel and Newtown, and she gets married. Married someone called Dave. After they have two children, they split up. Dave has an affair, and she moves to. They move to Southwood and Ferrer. They get a starter home there. Then they split up, and she moves to Malden. So she's moving north all the time. She moves to Malden, and then she starts studying to become a social worker at the University of Essex. And then she meets a guy there called Rob, who's an IT technician who makes a lot of money in the first dot-com boom, and they buy a house in Colchester. And they go on holiday, they get married, they go on holiday to India, they go to Taj Mahal, and he says, if you die before me, I will build you a Taj Mahal upon a stout. And she gets, one night, she gets run over by a moped in Colchester and dies, and he builds the Taj Mahal upon a stout, which is the house. And the moped is a chandelier that hangs in the living room of the chapel, and there it is. So that the headlights and the sidelights and the indicators all work and illuminate different artwork within the room. So I'm going to go very quickly, because I've gone on way too long. These are some sketches of the main bit in the living room, which is this bit where you walk between from the house to the chapel. And that moment is kind of, you burst through this thing, a bit like a kind of room screen from a medieval house or a cuckoo clock. The bedrooms and the doors from the other room kind of suddenly burst into this completely different world. So reference points again, rushes from the churches, and then so screens, mirrors, and kind of spatial and optical games. This is the plan, so that you go, come in, there's an entrance hall, go through the hall, shower upstairs, into the kitchen, dining room, and then you kind of, there's a massive fireplace, and that's sort of seemingly it. Fireplace has two doors in it. You push the fireplace doors and they burst open into the chapel space. Upstairs is the bathroom, which has a window which looks, when you're in the bathroom, you can see who's approaching the house. There also has a window which looks down into the stairwell. There are two bedrooms which have walk-through wardrobes, which then you go through the walk-through wardrobe, in fact, two sets of doors, and then you come out to the balcony. In the chapel. The two circular, semicircular balconies are from the bedrooms. The woman in between, the thing in between, is Julie herself. The tapestries on either side, by Grace, depict her two marriages. And then there's a whole load of other decorative shenanigans going on So very quickly through it, this is the kind of, it gets more intense as you go through it. So it starts off quite restrained and then it gets more and more bonkers as you go through the house. So you come into this bit, which is quite, has hints of the decoration of the colour scheme of theta, but it's quite restrained. And you kind of go through this corridor, the doors are leading you in this axial route to the fireplace. You go in and there's this sort of enormous tile fireplace. As well, and then when you open the doors, that opens into the chapel. It's a sort of idea of this space beyond domestic. And that space, that bit between, is got a line of mirrors. There's this sort of Julian mystic portal. When you step through this bit, you go from realm, one realm to the other. And then you kind of come out onto the porch, which has a mosaic with a sort of death mask. Supposedly the spot where Brock hears the news that she's died, and you put your feet on the eye sockets, and there's a line from the poem, basically, it's a poem about her, and it says, half of him in her have died. Very jolly. That's the bathroom, so in the bathroom you can kind of, the bathroom's a weird thing, basically, you take your life, you take your privacy into your own hands when you go to the bathroom. Never quite sure. There's a window internally which has a one-way mirror, which depending on the lighting levels, either side could mean that you're on show and everyone else is looking at you, or they're on show and you're looking at them. And there's a level of ambiguity as to which way that's going to go. And then the two bedrooms, one of which has this enormous tapestry of wedding photo number two, which is her getting married to Rob late for life. And when you're in the rooms at the top, the first book, you're kind of actually in the space of the room. And then, again, showing the idea that you kind of walk through the wardrobe and then out onto the balcony that looks into the main living room. And that's what you see when you come out, it's the living room. There's a wallpaper which is sort of vintage fragments of her life as well, and a pot. That's got the lights on. We're going to paint this as a gallery lighting. That I actually do that brilliant, but it's quite a spectacle. And then that's it. So there's when you look from the outside, you get these two enormous spaces in each of the door windows and the bedrooms running across the studio on the other side. You get her first marriage. So in a way, just to finish, I would say obviously, you know, the house sort of continues in a way a lot of the ideas of some of the earlier stuff, albeit with a kind of incredibly interesting new collaborator. But in it, one of the challenges of this house is like, how do you design a house that doesn't have an occupant? All that other stuff we've been talking about is like, well, a lot of the architecture is sort of built in a way, or the narrative, the stories come out of the people who live there and what they do. And this house, there isn't one, so that person's sort of invented. And their life and all their bits, all the stuff that we normally have in houses, the wedding photos, the bits, the knickknacks, the souvenirs from holidays, become kind of blown up, become the architecture of the house. So the wedding photo becomes an enormous tapestry that is in the bedroom. At a moment, it's almost like you come to the chandelier that hangs in the ceiling. So those sort of everyday accoutrements of life are something that sort of are invented to make. So that's it. Thank you very much.